Have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, reading from verses 23 through to the end, 34. It says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. For I received of the Lord that which I also delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And after the same manner also he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, This cup is the new testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep, for which if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, and we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that you come not together unto condemnation. And the rest will I set in order when I come." Let us pray. Father, we just want to thank you for this blessed day. A day, Lord, that we are called to remember your death and your burial. But Lord, it's a day which also, Lord, we set aside to break bread and to remember the Sunday is around the corner, that you rose from the grave. And so, Father, as we come now to break bread, we pray, Father, Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart will encourage our hearts during these times, but more than anything else, to bring us at a place of worshiping you for who you really are, and to see you, like Isaiah, high and lifted up, and your train filled our hearts. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. The Lord's Supper is an act of worship, and it is known as, in some instances, as the communion, which gets its name from 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 6, which says, 16, which says, "The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? And the bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ?" And that's why you see in some circles it's called the Holy Communion, or communion, or the communion. But oftentimes it is referred to as the breaking of bread. And that we get from Acts chapter 2 and verse 42, which says that, "And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers." As such, the Lord's Supper is a simple act in which the early Christians partake of by eating unleavened bread and drinking wine. It is an important act, one that we should understand why we do it, lest our participation becomes meaningless to us, lest our participation become displeasing to God, and lest our participation become detrimental to us, as was stated in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 27, which reads, "Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drink this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord." The next thing that we know about is that in terms of the meaning of the Lord's Supper and why we partake in it, is that the Lord's Supper is a memorial. 1 Corinthians 11 verse 23 says that, "For I received from the Lord that which I also passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.'" So in other words, then, here we see the Apostle Paul giving instructions to the believers, and he's giving it in a context of a memorial of remembering what Jesus Christ has done, and as such, we are called to remember. And so therefore then, we eat the bread in memory of Jesus' body, which was broken for us. And we drink the cup in the memory of his blood, which was poured out for the remissions of sins. As the Passover was a memorial commemorating Israel's deliverance from Egypt through the blood of the Lamb on the doorpost, so the Lord's Supper is a memorial of our Lord's death, who makes our deliverance from the bondage of sin becoming possible. Amen, my brothers and sisters. So the meaning of the Lord's Supper, not only is it a memorial, but it is also a proclamation. The scripture says in verse 26 of 1 Corinthians 11, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do what? You proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." We proclaim our faith in the finished work of Jesus' death on the cross, and we proclaim our faith in the Lord's return. Here it says that the proclamation is in the work that Jesus Christ did on the cross. And we also proclaim it till he comes. Meaning, therefore, then, we're not just going to talk about his death, but we're going to talk about his resurrection and his coming back again. And so, therefore, then, the Lord's Supper looks forward as well as backward, and will ever be observed by those who trust in his redemption and anticipate his return. And that's why we have the Lord's Supper. Because we are proclaiming that, yes, Jesus Christ was crucified. But we're also proclaiming that, yes, he rose from the grave. And we're also proclaiming that he will return one day. So not only is it a memorial and it's a proclamation, but it is also a communion. The cup of blessing, which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? And so as we partake, what the Apostle Paul is saying here is that as we partake in the Lord's Supper, the Holy Communion, or the breaking of bread, if you may call it so, he's saying that we commune with the blood of Christ and with the body of Jesus Christ. Now, I must say to you, with all the theology that I've studied, and with all the pastors I've sit around, and with all the preachings that I've heard, the extent to which we share in the body and in the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ as we partake in this Lord's Supper, I can tell you for certain, I don't know how it works out. I don't know God does that. I don't know he works all that out, how he does that. But here what happened? We dare not neglect whatever may be the benefits of coming to the Lord's table and participating and communioning with our God and Savior in this fashion. And to observe this Lord's Supper and to make sure that we're doing it in a manner that causes us to receive the benefit of the communion, the Lord's Supper, or the breaking of bread, for which God intends for us. There are about four things that I'd like to quickly just share with you. Firstly, we observe the Lord's Supper, and we do so with reverence. The scripture says, "Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and of the blood. May I say to you that the King James Version of this scripture passage uses the word worthily, which some have misunderstood, because the idea of the word worthily is used in an adverb kind of a sense. And what it does is describing how we are to take it, not whether we are worthy of taking it. That's two different things, you know. Two different things. It describes how we are to come to the Lord table to take it. Take it with an understanding of reverence. Take it with an understanding that we're going to do it worthily. Not that we are worthy of taking it, because none of us are truly worthy. It is all by God's grace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Not only is it to be done with reverence, but also is to be done with self-examination. The scripture says, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. A reflection upon your spiritual condition is what is being required. And as such, therefore, then, we are therefore then asked to look at ourselves and ask ourselves, am I living in a manner that is pleasing to the Lord? Or am I willfully sinning? Or am I refusing to be repentant about my sins and thereby doing what? Crucifying again Jesus Christ and putting him to shame. That's what the self-examination is about. Are you living in a manner that is pleasing to the Lord? Or are you willfully sinning? Or are you refusing to be repentant about your sins and thereby crucifying the Lord again? And so therefore then, the Lord's Supper is a private matter between a Christian and the Lord. A time to reflect on the past and a time to resolve, how are you going to move forward? Because you cannot come to the Lord's table and go back being the same way you were. And that's why there's a communion, not just a communion of the brethren, not just a communion of the name Holy Communion. There's a communion in the body and in the blood and in the presence of the Lord. And you cannot come into the presence of God and remain the same and leave from the Lord's table, leave from the Holy Communion, leave from the breaking of bread event and not resolve to live more righteously, not resolve to live more holy, and not resolve to live a life more pleasing unto God. Thirdly, the observance of the Lord's Supper is that it's to be done with Christians. And that goes without saying. The Bible said, now on the first day of the week, the disciples came together to break bread. Paul, ready to depart for the next day to speak to them and to continue his message until midnight. The brothers and sisters, the Lord's Supper, the Holy Communion for which we partake of, is about building fellowship with one another as well as with the Lord. That's what the Lord's Supper is about. The fellowship, the body of Christ, the Christians, we all come together and we break bread and we fellowship one with another. When we come to the Lord's Supper, it's supposed to bring us closer, not divide us further. Nor is it supposed to be a time where we start to judge people harshly. Who not take from who not take, and who you know this not take for the longest while or whatever it is. It means that you never come to the Lord's table with the right attitude. You come to the Lord's table to break bread, fellowship with the brethren, but your eyes must be on Christ. Lastly, but by no means least, when we come to the Lord's table in terms of its observance, we are to do it often. Because you know why we need to do it often? We need to do it often so that we can remember We need to do it often so that it makes us resolve to live more worthily. We are to do it often so that we can bring ourselves together and worship the Lord together. This morning, as we come to break bread or to have Holy Communion with the Lord, we do so knowing its meaning. It's a memorial. We do so with its observance of reverence unto the Lord.